The next section in Schelling's System of Transcendental Idealism is Part 2. It's called The General Deduction of Transcendental Idealism. And Schelling begins the chapter by recapping briefly and saying, so now we've established that. We've posited the self. The self has posited itself in this fundamental act of intuition, this intellectual intuition whereby it has posited itself as its own object. But what he wants to do then is to, before going any further, to move into a deduction, that is to say, a justification of transcendental idealism, which he says here, transcendental idealism isn't the same thing as the science of knowledge. It's going to be a larger system, remember, because he's going to attempt to reconcile Natur philosophy with Fichte. So it's going to be larger than Fichte's. But what he wants to do then is he says that there is both a practical and a theoretical aspect to transcendental idealism. And now the next step is to wonder how it can be the case then that the entire outer world, the entire objective world, can be deduced from this initial internal principle of the I am. So how does this happen? What mechanism is it that generates the outer world for the self? What is the mechanism that brings this into being? And in understanding that mechanism, then we'll understand how it is that both the theoretical and the practical portions of transcendental philosophy are comprised under a single system, because he wants to try to deduce everything, all these other principles, from this initial I am. So in order to do this, what he says is that the first thing we have to realize is that the self has posited itself. In positing itself, this positing of itself is an act. That is to say, it's something that has happened, whereas it was preceded by a time when this did not happen. The self was not aware of itself. It was simply this pure consciousness, pure, original, infinite activity. It may have been a blind activity, but it was this original, infinite, unself-aware activity. And in the moment of positing itself as an object, of turning the self into the self as an object, in turning something into an object, you automatically define it as something finite. Every object is a finite thing. And so in positing itself as finite, without reference to the external world, it's not, the external world doesn't take this into account. The external world doesn't affect this, rather. It doesn't, it's not a factor that impinges on this original act of self-consciousness. But when this act happens, the self is posited as an object for itself, and it becomes finite. So it becomes a finite self in that very act, which means that originally it wasn't finite. It had to become finite. So the self became an object. It didn't begin that way. It started out as a subject of pure consciousness, this pure state of infinite activity, of pure infinite striving was its original state. Now, at the same time, in positing itself as a finite self, as an object of itself, at the same time, the not-self comes into being along with it. The not-self is the counter-posited to the positing of the self. Those two are posited as reciprocally conditioning each other, as was the same case for Fichte, through one and the same act of positing. But the interesting thing here is that the self, there's a paradox in that the self is originally something that is infinite and is characterized by the state of infinite striving. This infinite striving towards an always deferred horizon. The self, in positing the self, constructs an outer world for itself that functions as a restriction, a limitation upon its pure activity. And this limitation is a boundary. He calls it in this chapter, the not-self is a boundary. And so we imagine a boundary that the self encounters, that the pure infinite activity of the self, in this ideal sense, encounters in the real world. It always encounters this boundary, and that the very nature of this limitation is precisely what gives to the self its infinite striving. It doesn't have this infinite strength. So the self is unlimited precisely insofar as it's limited, and vice versa. It's a bit of a paradox, but this is the way Schelling puts it. And so he says that, so in real terms, the self, the finite self, encounters this boundary, the obstacle C, let's say, that is the object in the outer world, excuse me, that it encounters. But since in terms of its ideal sense, it's always striving beyond that, that boundary is constantly getting deferred to infinity. So there's this ideal aspect to the boundary where it represents the infinite, that the ideal pure self is striving toward. But meanwhile, it's invented this finite self, which has invented a finite world, to create a tension between finite self and finite world, which is the real, the world of the real. And that limitation, that fundamental limitation, is precisely what allows it to do the whole process of its becoming. Otherwise, it can't become a self. It would just, if it didn't have this limitation, then it would simply just suddenly expand to infinity. And there would be no reason for it to postulate an outer world at all. So the outer world has to be there in order for this to happen. So we have four terms, in a sense. We have this, the infinite. We have the real boundary, the infinitely deferred boundary, the real boundary, the finite self, and the absolute self that has brought all of this into being through this initial act of positing self, not self, and boundary. So insofar as it can be said that the self is the is as the subject is what has posited this boundary, we have the ideal. And the ideal is the theoretical aspect of transcendental philosophy. Insofar as it can be said that the boundary has been constructed in an ideal sense by the subject itself, the infinite self, the infinite subject. But it can be said to be real insofar as the outer world of the boundary is real independently of the self. That's realism, and that is also a division that will come under practical philosophy in the system of transcendental idealism. So both the boundary as posited by, created by the subject, is ideal, and as it is in and of itself, without regard for the self, becomes real. And that accounts for how the two aspects of the theoretical and the practical come to comprise a single system of transcendental idealism that he will then set about here trying to reconcile. And so that's the general deduction in this chapter of transcendental idealism. So the key of it is understanding how the self limits itself by postulating a finite self that serves as a limitation on its own internal free activity. And the whole reason, you might say, what is the reason for postulating an infinite self to begin with? And part of it is, or really the core of it, I think, is that that infinite activity, that pure productivity of the infinite self, is precisely the source of our freedom. Freedom, which is the key concept in all German idealist philosophy, is anchored in the abyss of the freedom of the free self in that original infinite activity. So it has to be there as an intrinsic part of what it is that they're trying to do, because they're trying to get around this idea of an external world that's strictly deterministic. And it ends up being this, I think, in Anglo philosophy. The Anglo world takes too scientific a view of the world, and it simply assumes that the world is what it appears to be. We end up with Darwin. All this starts with Newman. We end up Newton. We end up with Darwin. And the external world just becomes this rigidly necessary system of cause-effect. And pretty soon you wind up with B.F. Skinner and behaviorism, in which we have no freedom at all, and we're simply lab rats running around a cage responding to external stimuli, and we all become like Kafka's Gregor Samsa, who wakes up as a bug one morning because science turned man into a bug by robbing him of freedom. And that's the essence of Kafka's metamorphosis, is to show this is what the ravages of the Darwinian worldview have done to man in the age in which freedom no longer exists. And it will slowly disappear out of philosophy as German idealism winds down. Heidegger is perhaps its last defender. And as German idealism winds down, the concept that we are internally free, that we're autonomous, that we contain this infinite abyss within us that can originate spontaneous causes that we can insert into the chain of the realm of the necessary in the outer world, once that disappears, you end up with a very shallow, flat, two-dimensional view of the human being, and we get all the science fiction utopias and dystopias of 20th century literature, such as Kafka's Metamorphosis and stories of that nature, which depict the human being as nothing more than a lab rat with no autonomy, no freedom, and pretty soon, nobody's responsible for their own activities anymore, and they're just constantly blaming their parents, they're blaming the economy, they're blaming the outer world, they're blaming natural selection, anything but the taking of responsibility for one's own actions in the abysses of one's own internal freedom. And German philosophy is the antidote to all of that, because it's all based on this idea that everything begins with the freedom of the autonomous, spontaneous, self-generating self. And from out of that, everything else follows. And so that's really the upshot of what Schelling's getting at, I think, in this chapter.